Welcome to the Insomnicat Show with Nicolette and Brian. We'll get real deep with you, educating, inspiring, and solving problems with some of the most inspirational humans on the planet. Buckle up and come on the journey.
I'm excited.
All right, guys, I'm Nicolette, and today Brian and I are here with Stacy Kessler. She is a small business strategist, and she's going to talk to us a little bit about the entrepreneur spirit, and we're going to have a little bit of fun. So thank you so much for joining us, Stacy. We really appreciate your time today.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
So why don't you kick us off by telling us a little bit about yourself and your journey to becoming a boss lady?
Yeah, so I've wanted to be an entrepreneur as long as I can remember. I still remember when I was like 6 years old and I would make stationery out of I'd hand carve potato stamps out of potato, and I'd put Lisa Frank stickers on piece of paper and I'd sell them to people. Now, business was good back then when your parents cover all your operating expenses.
That's capital. That's right.
but yeah, so fast forward through to college, went to business school, and then entered into the corporate world where I did consumer understanding and brand strategy work for a handful of years. The work was challenging, it was fun, but it wasn't very meaningful and fulfilling for me. So I knew I wanted to leave and do something else, and I explored everything under the sun. Is it time to open my own business? Is it, time to maybe start a nonprofit? Do I want to just go get a different job? And ultimately, I ended up leaving and opening up a co-working space, of all things, but it combined a lot of passions for me, building community, creating innovative spaces, and supporting small businesses and entrepreneurs. And I knew that wasn't the end-all, be-all, but it gave me the opportunity to, one, create a space that I knew I needed, because one, did not exist in my city of Cincinnati at the time, and two, it gave me the opportunity to experiment on how I can better serve small businesses and entrepreneurs, which is where my true passion really lies. So fast forward a couple of years, and I started consulting with them, learned that I was really good at helping them with their strategy, decided to launch a business around that, and decided to sell the co-working space so I could focus on that full time. And here we are.
Awesome. So you mentioned that you kind of knew you were an entrepreneur at heart, even as as a young girl. So, our question is, how do you know if you have the entrepreneur spirit?
Yeah, I feel like there's just something inside you where you want to create. I feel like people who are sort of destined to be entrepreneurs see opportunity in everything. They get a lot of ideas, but they also have a desire to do something about it. But I think where the difference really comes in is you have to have a key motivator. And so I feel like there's four kind of key motivators for entrepreneurs. I have this acronym called FAME, F-A-I-M, which in French actually means hunger. So I'd be like, I love a good. So FAME stands for flexibility, achievement, impact, and money. And so I feel like if you have any one of those motivations really strong within you, those can be something that can drive you towards successful entrepreneurship. You might have all of them, but I feel like all entrepreneurs are driven strongly by one. I feel like a lot of the really successful ones are driven really strongly by impact and sort of a desire to help outside of themselves. And that gives them this sort of extrinsic motivation to keep going even when the time gets tough, whereas some of the other ones are more personal. And I feel like maybe that's not always enough to keep you going through the ups and downs of entrepreneurship. But I feel like I always knew, and maybe this is a misconception, so I'm like, all entrepreneurs must know. Mm-hmm. We're just made for it.
Do you think it's something that's, you're almost, I don't want to say you're born with, but it's just part of your basic core principle? Because a lot of people who own businesses or entrepreneurs come from lines of entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. right? So you see a lot of them, that's in their, in their makeup, So do you see a lot of that also?
Yeah, absolutely. I do not come from a line of entrepreneurs, but I think there was a study done, and that was the number one indicator, was that one of your parents was an entrepreneur. I think that's definitely something that rings true. If it's in your heritage and you grew up around that, or you just had this desire from birth, maybe you just got the right genes from your parents that made it a perfect combo. I think some people do stumble into it, though, or are forced into it. Maybe you're laid off, or...
Right.
a random opportunity presents itself and you discover that, hey, I really like this and I'm really good at it, but I feel like the people who are in it for the long haul always have an inkling kind of earlier on in their life that knew they'd probably eventually land there.
And do you, I mean, most entrepreneurs
want it. I never thought of that, Brian. Like, we've never talked about this before. And it's funny because both of our dads, you know, did their own thing, right? And and that's funny because I've never thought of that before. And that actually wasn't what I thought I was going to do with my life. You know, that wasn't my thing. I just thought I was going to go, you know, do something path of least resistance, you know? That's interesting, actually. You may be giving food for thought today. Thank you, guys.
I think the other thing, too, is most entrepreneurs have a tendency to be huge risk takers, right? You know, they're not adverse to risk. It's sort of what they do, you know, is another thing, which I think is a trait in people that they're sort of born with. You know, some people are more risk takers from the beginning than others.
Yeah. Absolutely. Because, I mean, everything about business is a risk. You're putting yourself out there in every way possible. So you're right. You definitely have to have that natural inclination, I believe.
Wow. Now, you know, Stacy, you mentioned, you know, what like successful entrepreneurs are really driven by that impact, you said, right? Yeah. Now, what other like characteristics or what are the habits of these other successful entrepreneurs that you've seen in your experience?
Yeah, I think the biggest one is just this desire and ability to discover and tap into what your unique brand of genius is, which is just what I call like all the things that make us amazing. Because the fact of the matter is that no two people on earth have the exact same combinations of like natural gifts, learned experiences, skills you've developed, passions, things you enjoy. And so when you can tap into like, what's the unique combination of those, I feel like that's when you can really develop a one-of-a-kind business that looks like no one else's. And when you do that, I think that's when you're most likely to experience that impact and that success and enjoy what you're doing and be able to be in it for the long haul. But I feel like that's something that a lot of us struggle with. But I think when you're able to do that, that's where I think that's one of the biggest indicators of success, because you're competing on a plane that no one else is. You're not just trying to be like a Me Too brand or one up your competition. You're doing something that only you can do the best.
Right.
Now, when do companies go from being, right, like an entrepreneurship or small business to that next level? Like, where's that defining line? Like, we recently had a discussion with another person about this. Like, where's that defining line?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I don't know if there is a defining line. I feel like it's, I don't know, maybe a mindset. I feel like when you're an entrepreneur, at least the ones that I'm surrounded by, because when you have that entrepreneurial spirit, I feel like you always kind of call yourself an entrepreneur. But some people might buy a business instead of starting a business. And I feel like maybe they might consider themselves a business owner instead. But I feel like there's a certain mindset you tap into where you all of a sudden start seeing yourself more as like a CEO of your company, rather than like the founder and the principal and the one woman or one man show kind of a thing. And I think once you get out of that mindset of being a solopreneur, I feel like that's probably when it shifts.
Right. Yeah. Cause I mean, you look at people like Elon Musk, right? Which everyone's saying he's an entrepreneur, but he is and he isn't. And his whole family's a whole bunch of entrepreneurs, but he's the richest man in the world. I don't know if he still is, but you know, he's the richest man in the world. Is he still an entrepreneur, or are those businesses so established, but he's always creating new things? So he's always sort of like an entrepreneur, regardless of, you know, the business tact.
Yeah. I mean, I would venture to say that he's a serial entrepreneur. Yeah. He's got a little more resources at his disposal than the average entrepreneur, which helps because he has made it to a certain level. But I still think when you're creating and founding and starting things and innovating in ways that no one else is, I feel like that's the definition of an entrepreneur.
I like that.
Yeah.
No, Stacy, I mean, you do have a focus on women entrepreneurs, right? Mm-hmm. Now, my question is, do you find that women entrepreneurs struggle with things that are different than, let's say, males? And if so, I'm sure there are common struggles, right? So I guess the first question is, what are the common ones? And then what are some struggles that you see that are more specific to the females?
Yeah, I definitely think there's a lot of common struggles, but I do think there's some things that women struggle with a little bit more, which is one of the reasons that I love working with them so much. So I think we all struggle with, like I mentioned before, that unique brand of genius, like honing in on what that is, because we're so close to it. Sometimes it's hard to see what our genius is, what our superpowers are. So I think that's one that we all struggle with. I think depending on what your skills are, there might be different business acumen that you might struggle with. Maybe it's money, maybe it's marketing, maybe it's strategy, maybe it's execution. I think one that is really interesting is, I mentioned one of the key motivators is like flexibility. A lot of people want to live this ideal lifestyle and be their own boss. And while that's awesome and you get that a lot of times when you become an entrepreneur, sometimes you need to enforce structure on yourself to actually be productive and to build those habits and those routines and those rhythms that allow you to really succeed. And I think that's hard for people to do. And they don't want to just create another job for themselves or, you know, be a boss themselves. So I think that's tough too. And then imposter syndrome is a huge one. I do think that most people struggle with that. There's conflicting studies on whether men or women struggle with that more, but I believe, based on what I've seen, that women do struggle with that more. I think there was an actual study where in like employment situations, men characteristically overconfidently state what their qualifications are, and women are always understating. And I think that that lends itself to more imposter syndrome in women, because it's kind of a confidence thing, thinking that you either don't deserve the success you've got, or like, who am I to be able to do this? Do I have a right to do this? And I think that women uniquely struggle with that. And when I'm working with my clients, that's probably one of the number one mindset shifts that they have, is when I can help them see what their unique brand of genius is and how you can craft a one-of-a-kind business around that. It's like a light bulb goes off and they start to become more confident in their skills. And that's one of the reasons I love to work with them the most.
So for everyone watching that doesn't know what imposter syndrome is, can you define that a little bit?
Yeah. So imposter syndrome is just this idea that we might not have a confidence in that we are deserving of the success that we've achieved or the place that we've gotten to, or that we don't have a right or the skill set or the ability to do what we want to do or what we're doing. So for example, a marketer might have imposter syndrome and feel like, well, who am I to like go and market someone else's business? I'm still figuring out the perfect way to market mine. And they're kind of like tearing themselves down and feeling like they don't have the skills to do what they're really good at. And other people would say they're amazing at, and we just can't see it ourselves.
I'd say like the one sentence, and you said it, the one phrase that I always think of is like, well, who am I to do that? Right. I mean, that's how I always think of it. You know, who am I to do this? You know, why would anyone listen to me? Or, you know, things like that are really how I always interpret that.
Yeah, absolutely. Have you struggled with that at all, Brian?
I go to the beat of my own drummer. I'm just being honest. Like I really do. Like I'm a typical, gives no, you know, what's about things. Like I just, you know, I figure out what I think is the right thing to do. And I'm not afraid also to fail. So I think it lends itself a little bit more to just my personality. Do you know what I mean? And the things I do in life, like, you know, I mean, what do I say, Nicolette, all the time? Test stuff. You're going to fail 100 times and you're going to figure it out, you know, and it doesn't, you know, it. So I don't know. I guess I don't really think I do.
No, he definitely doesn't. And I've worked with Brian for over 10 years. And so luckily I've had him leading and guiding me along this way, right? So I actually overcompensate for my insecurity by pretending like I know more than I do, which is funny because I that's how I compensate and I deal with that feeling is I'm then maybe overly confident, and that's also not a good thing, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think that's so telling, Brian, because I do think there is a personality factor to it too. But I do think you probably represent a larger portion of what males feel than we don't often hear women say what you just said as confidently as you said. Like, we might know these things and principles, but we're much more likely to throw like sorry in our phrases for like no reason. We shouldn't be saying sorry, or you know, qualifying things, or or like expecting a turn down and a no before we even get one. Like, it's okay if you say no, but I thought I'd have to ask. And it's like, why do we even say those things? Like, most men do not qualify their phrases in those ways.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I keep telling like everyone that, you know, in my life, that they're all in trouble when I get old, because I really don't care about things now. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm a natural risk taker, you know? So like, you guys are in trouble when I'm like really old and I really don't care.
It's going to be amazing. Yeah. You're just going to be like, you know, your old wise man, and just living life the way you want to. And
yeah, well, I think everyone should, right? Regardless, you know, I really do. I think everyone should, you know, try their best. I mean, don't get me wrong. We all have to, there's all compromises in there, because we got to make money and we have to do this, but you try to, you know, live it the best you can and do it the best you can. And that's it. But I'm also one of those people, like, if I'm not going to do something 150%, like, I won't do it. Like, I just won't. I won't do it. Like, it's not worth it to me, you know? So I'm one of those people, like, if I'm not going to put everything into it, it's hard. And I think that's, you know, so I stay away from those things that have a tendency not to be something that I'm going to put 150% in.
And it's not because you don't want to, it's just, you know, your own, you know, what you're capable of at that time, in, you know, at that point in time. So while we're on the topic of Brian, though, I want to bring up this concept of minimalism. Okay.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
Okay. So now I read a recent article on your site about minimalist principles. Okay. So Brian's a minimalist. I mean, he's got no things. I've got all the things in the world. And I want to talk about how you say that minimalist principles can actually boost your business. Can we please talk about that?
Yeah. So I am a huge fan of minimalism. I'm not your typical, like, extreme minimalist. I mean, you can see I got stuff in my background. I might be a plant hoarder. That's the antithesis of my
That's okay. That's oxygen for you to breathe. It's more for your brain to get, right?
Exactly. We're taking the air purifiers in my home and replacing them with plants.
That's great.
But yeah, I think there's so much that's applicable to entrepreneurship from minimalism. So minimalism is the idea of like focusing, right? So it's focusing on the things that matter and letting the things that don't matter go. And that is, I think, one of the keys to a successful business. So we talk about the riches being in the niches. And I know a lot of people are like afraid of that. Like, I don't want to pigeonhole myself. But when you can figure out what you really stand for as a business and where you want to focus, what your vision is, everything becomes so much more clear. And if you can use that as guideposts in your business to say, this is what's important, so these are the hell yeses, and this is what's not important, and so these are the definite no's, you're going to be so much more impactful than if you're trying to do everything and be everything to everyone. You're really going to resonate with no one, and you're not going to do anything extremely well. And then I think tactically, actually, being a minimalist in your life and reducing the physical clutter and maybe the digital clutter and other things around you, I think reduces a lot of the distraction and the stress. I think we don't realize how much our environment can impact us. And when I let go of a lot of the items, you know, around me that weren't serving me, it was like a huge relief. And I started getting more creative and able to focus more easily. So I think there's also a tangible, like, physical and mental benefit as well.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's like this. I think, like, when you have a lot of stuff, right? And that stuff could be anything, whatever it is. It's like a giant weight you're carrying around, like, all the time. And I always say I have clutter blindness. Like, if there's stuff all over the counter and my keys are in that pile, like, I just can't look at that pile and see my keys. Like, you know, and it's just, but it's the same thing, like, to your point, it's the same thing in business. The more, those more distractions, those more things that are flying back and forth, if you're not focused on some, you know, core principles, it gets really, really tough to see the path, you know, and where you need to go, especially if you're an entrepreneur.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's, so I was reading this book, I think it was in the book Goodbye Things by Fumio Sasaki, and he talks about how your possessions have, like, they send you silent messages, which sounds like super woo-woo. But I was like, okay, what does he really mean? So I started just paying attention to it. I would like open a cabinet and be like, all right, what's speaking to me? And it was actually so true. There were all these messages like, you wasted money over here. If you actually read that business book, maybe your business would be doing better. Like, you know, oh, if you actually worked out a little bit more, you could fit in these clothes. And there were all messages I was getting that you don't internalize, but subconsciously they're affecting you all the time. And digitally as well. Like if you are saying, okay, I am going to market my business in these 20 ways, even if you're not actively doing that, but you have the intention of doing that, you know that's not possible unless you have a massive team to consistently do that really impactfully. And so you're always going to have this like this guilt or this kind of, oh, I should be doing that, or like this tension of I'm not able to do what I said I'm going to do. But if instead you just commit to, okay, these three channels are where I'm going to focus and I'm doing it really well, just making that commitment, even though you're not changing your actions, will totally free you up, reduce that shame and that guilt. And it makes all the difference and able to be impactful in the places you are serving.
Yeah, absolutely. We tell people that all the time, like focus on growing one channel at a time, like whether you want to grow whatever it is, your newsletter, your Instagram, whatever it is, YouTube, you know, focus on one or one YouTube channel versus five YouTube channels.
We struggle with that ourselves, Brian.
Yeah, we do.
It's funny because we tell other people to do that, right? And then we struggle with that internally.
We've been pretty good about it.
We have been. We've gotten better. I just want to bring up one thing you said, and you talk about like, you know, focusing on a niche and, you know, defining your values and then like letting everything else go. Now, my question is, what do you do when you need money, when money comes from those other things that are not in line with what your actual goals are?
Yeah, I think that is one of the most difficult decisions that entrepreneurs have to make. But when you can confidently lean into those and say no, that's when stuff really starts happening. So let me give you an example. I was getting really clear on who my ideal client was, who I wanted to serve. And that was basically women solopreneurs with kind of service-based business, coaches, consultants, creatives, those kind of businesses. And I had several opportunities come towards me all at once. One was like a larger company. Another one was a man who was trying to build this business. Another guy had like a team and was kind of like contracting. And I was like, none of these are a fit, but they all wanted to hire me. Money was great. And I didn't have a full book of clients that I wanted to have at the moment. And I chose in that moment to say no to them. And within the next week, I was full to capacity with clients that I did want. And had I taken on those other projects, I wouldn't have had the capacity to serve the people that I really wanted to be serving. But it was definitely a risk and a leap of faith to say no. And sometimes when we keep in this pattern of saying yes to every opportunity, every client, every project, every idea, we don't make time or have time when the right opportunities come along. We don't have the space to create the right things for our business. And when you can get in that mindset, confidently say no, and just like trust in abundance and not have that scarcity mindset, I think that's when your business really starts to take off.
I agree. I think I've said something like this, Brian. I swear.
Yeah, we just recently talked about this like a couple of days ago, you know, because I think, you know, and I think what happens too with a lot of startups, you know, they're so worried about revenue, right? Whatever that revenue is and what it looks like. And sometimes, like we've seen this so many times where they even take on projects that they're almost losing money on. And it's like, why are you doing that? You know, and I think every company's been guilty of that, like every company since the beginning of time has probably been guilty of doing that. And, you know, that's one of the things I think that sometimes entrepreneurs don't see right away. You know?
Yeah, I just wrapped up with this client who I love working with. She's an interior designer, and she had like on paper a really like good business. Like her revenue was up. She had like 26 projects and all this stuff. And then she was like, I'm drowning. I'm like I'm like, I'm not even surviving, let alone thriving. And like, where's my money going? Like, I'm making all this money. Where's it going? So like, dug in, and we're like, revenue does not equal profitability. And you're not charging enough on these projects, and you're not taking on the right projects to actually be profitable in your business. So you know, this equation isn't working. You're working for nothing, basically. And so we totally revamped that over the course of a couple of months. And it's, she went from doing projects for like $5,000 to working on $100,000 projects. And it took her a long time to get out of that sort of scarcity mindset of saying no to those smaller projects that she didn't want to be working on. But once she started saying no, then the right projects came along.
Right. Yeah. I think it's the old, I mean, I'm sure you've seen this. I don't know if it's an old adage or meme or whatever. It's like, you know, the $5 client, you know, causes all these problems, but the $5 million client's like, great, thanks. Send me the invoice. You know,
I just said that to you. You remember it, right?
Yeah. No, well, it's a meme. It's around forever. But yeah.
I don't know. It was the first time I had seen it. And I was like, wow, really?
But yeah. But you know, it's an old like adage, I guess you could say. But you know, it's so true, you know, in that aspect. Like sometimes those smaller clients demand a lot more work for a lot less money. And like you're saying, almost no profit. Whereas the bigger clients, you know, they understand it a little bit better. So,
yeah, absolutely. It's
harder to get, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, and it's interesting because it's like, you could almost, once you're out of that mindset, you can almost spot them from a mile away. It's like the person who, before they even meet with you, is like, do you offer discounts, or can I just purchase an hour with you, or something like that? And you're like, okay, there's going to be other red flags too.
Yeah. My favorite is the brain pickers. We did a video on this, like people who just like, they sit there and they want to have conversation after conversation after conversation. And it's like, look, either you hire us or you don't. Like, it becomes a certain point where, you know, stop kicking the tires and brain picking, and either you engage or you don't engage.
Yeah. You know,
those, to me, those are the worst. Those are the worst companies to work with.
Yeah. My least favorite are the ones that come in like, you have something to prove to me.
Yeah.
And my background's in market research. And so I ask certain questions in my intake questionnaire and stuff like that. One of them is, you know, what hesitations, questions, or concerns you have about working with me. And this one person wrote like, I need you to prove to me that you are not like every other consultant that's ever been a waste of my money. And I was like, I feel like you're just going to be like looking for the thing to be like, oh, see, you proved me right. I mean, we're always looking for things to prove us right.
Yeah. Well, and on that point, those people that are like, I fired everyone, or everyone sucked out, did what you did for me in the past, you're like, yeah, this is just not going to end well. So why get involved? Like, that's, you know, that should be your mindset as an entrepreneur. Like, you know, you're not going to be, I mean, you are different than those other people that came before, and maybe they really did suck, but the client's no different. You know, the client's no different than what
they're working with. Yeah.
All right. Well, Stacy, I would love to have you back one day to talk about scarcity mindset, because I really like that. So let's table that idea. You give me a good one there. But in the meantime, I would love if you could let everybody know where they can learn more about you and what you do and what you're working on. You have a pretty robust website with a lot of stuff there. So please let us know.
Yeah, absolutely. You can visit me at my website, stacykessler.me. And I've got a whole slew of free resources there. You can sign up for a free monthly event that I do for women entrepreneurs called Boss Lady Day. It's this amazing community of women who come together to support each other each month. And you can also learn more about working with me if you're someone that's struggling to figure out what is the uniqueness in your business and how to create something that's more enjoyable and compelling and profitable, either from scratch or whether you're just in this phase of drowning, like that client I mentioned before. I would love to chat with you, and you can learn more on my website.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Stacy. We really appreciate your time today.
Thank you for having me.